Hi everyone, thank you so much for tuning in and welcome back to you if you're coming back again. And if you're new, thank you so much for coming and taking the time out to watch this video. So today I'm going to talk about something that I really, really love and really passionate about, and it's all about tissue viability and pressure areas. So firstly, a pressure area or a pressure sore, a pressure ulcer is basically some damage or an injury caused to the skin that has stemmed from pressure to that area and the blood supply has been cut off basically. So if you're lying flat on a hard surface, for example, it's gonna block off the blood supply and cause damage and skin breakdown. So firstly, before we go into the categories of pressure ulcers, I just wanted to say that wherever you're working, there should be a risk assessment in place already where they will risk assess each patient on admission if they're at danger of developing a pressure ulcer or pressure sore, or if their nutrition status is really poor, fluid balance is really poor, anything like that, they could be at risk of pressure ulcers. So just have a look at your local trust policies and procedures, how you assess patients and how you do things, and just go from there. These pressure areas are usually seen in the more bony prominence of the human body. So you will have elbows, knees, heels, ankles, you'll have the spine, sacrum, shoulder blades, ears as well sometimes, back of the head, sometimes the big toe, anywhere that is bony basically, that hasn't got any fleshy, meaty bit that's going to protect it as much as the rest of your body. And these are usually due to actually prolonged pressure on that particular area. This isn't just like a short-term thing, this is more of a prolonged pressure and it's going to result in that sore appearing. But sometimes these can form over a few hours as well, not necessarily days or months. This can be over a few hours. You might see some red blanching areas, which is the sign of the start of the pressure ulcer or sore starting to happen. So what does red blanching even mean? So red blanching is where if you've got a red area on the skin, you press it like that and it should go white. So you press it down, it's white, and then it goes back to the pink red color. But if you're pressing it and there's no blanching at all, then that means it's just gone that little bit stage up and the pressure damage has really started basically. But it's red blanching, it's not good, but it's not bad. It just might mean that that person's been lying in a certain position for far too long and they really need to be moved and they should be repositioned more frequently just to stop that pressure. So when it gets to that point where it's not blanching, you're pressing it, there's no white, it's just completely red, that is classed as a category one pressure sore. This means that a person will have to be repositioned more frequently. Some extra steps will have to be put in place to protect that and stop the skin from breaking down further, like a barrier cream. And the skin around it and the skin covering it will be intact as well, just to point that out. It will just be red, but it won't be broken. There'll be no broken areas or anything like that. There'll be no blisters. It's just purely a red spot, but you have to put those extra precautions in place to prevent that from happening. So if there is some skin loss, so there'll be partial thickness of the pressure area, there'll be some skin loss. Sometimes it can look like a small blister or a large blister, but there'll be no bruising, there'll be no redness, no darkness underneath. It'll just be a clear blister, round in shape, and that's even without the skin being broken as such. And that sort of pressure ulcer should be reported and it should be documented as well in the patient notes. But the tissue viability nurses don't need to be contacted at this point, just your Datex reporting, however, whichever guidelines or policies, procedures for your local trust, whatever they say to do, do that basically. So category three, when there's full thickness skin loss included in this, so then there will be some fat exposed, but there's not going to be bone, muscles, tendons, anything like that. None of that will be exposed yet, but there will be some fats maybe exposed in this blister area or this open broken skin area. And with the category three, you must also report this, fill in the Datex, and you should also refer to the tissue viability nurses in your local trust. So category four pressure ulcer, this is a step up again. You're going to have full tissue loss. You're going to have muscle exposed, tendon exposed, sometimes bone exposed. This might also include what they call undermining or tunneling, which is where the pressure ulcer is quite deep, but there's a little hole where it's tunneling underneath even further, and you can't actually measure it, and you don't know how deep that is actually going because you can't physically see it. And that's when you have to get the probe and measure sort of into that area to sort of assess how deep this is. This also depends where this category four is. If this is on the sacrum area, the buttocks, somewhere that's got a bit of meat to it, this might be a lot deeper. But if this is on an ear or an elbow, ankle, then this can be quite a shallow grade four, if that makes sense, because there's not as much fatty tissue or muscle or anything like that around to break through. But if it's going to be on the buttocks or anything like that, this is going to be so much but worse than it is. And I think that's where the confusion between the categories might come in. And you sort of might have a bit of debate with colleagues or nurses about what sort of category this actually is. And you might have to get advice from the tissue viability nurses as a result. So deep tissue injury is the one that I don't like. This is the one that I hate the most because you have no idea what is going on underneath. So this is gonna look really red, really like dark, 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 angry red color. It's gonna look dark purple, black. It's gonna be non-blanching at all. This coloring might be under a blister as well. So usually blisters are quite clear and there's fluid inside, but sometimes you can have a blister and it'll be dark purple underneath. That's gonna be a deep tissue injury because that coloring is telling you that it's going deeper down. With this sort of category pressure ulcer, you need to fill in a detex incident report again, report this, but you don't necessarily have to make a tissue viability referral to this. Just keep monitoring it and put your measures in place like hourly returning, area creams, things like that, to try and stop this from breaking down further, and hopefully it'll resolve. But if in doubt, you can always contact your tissue viability team, who are a massive, massive help. And next is unstageable. So I think this is the equivalent to ungradable back on the old grading systems. So it'll be unstageable or ungradable because you're looking at it and you've got no idea. You don't know how deep it is. You can't really work out what's going on underneath because there's so much slough on top. And as well as being sloughy, this might be necrotic. So there might be some dead black skin areas to this particular wound site. And that again needs to be reported. The datex has to be filled in. And this absolutely must have to refer to the tissue viability nurses so that extra measures can be put in place to minimize this and resolve. And if you're out in the community, so if you're a community nurse, this category and the unstageable category must be reviewed weekly by the district nurse or the community nurse. So sometimes the oxygen masks can leave marks, the tubing, the nasal specs can leave marks behind the ears, on the nose. Also people out there, healthcare professionals out there who put the pulse oximeter supposedly for the finger, who put it on the ear, which it should not be on the ear at all because this is what it can cause. It can cause burning, it can cause pressure ulcers, it can cause all sorts of problems because it's been put in the wrong place. There are proper ear sats pulse oximeters that you can use on the ears, and it's worth looking into that if you've got a patient that really needs that sort of level of monitoring, if that makes sense, just to prevent that pressure ulcer from happening. Also catheter tubing, so sometimes if a catheter's been on a particular side of the leg for a long period of time and nobody's monitored, it can leave really red markings. Also from toilet seats, if they've been sat on a toilet seat for far too long, it can cause that ring around it. Blood pressure cuff's been on too long, can leave markings. I've seen photos of this as well. I haven't seen any of these happen out there in practice, but it does happen. I've seen photos, and just from the training that I had, just made me a lot more aware of these things that can happen, and hopefully I'm going to prevent this when I go out there in practice. And this type of pressure also has to be datex reported, and also the tissue viability nurses included if it's a category 3, 4 or unstageable. And last but not least, the wonderful, wonderful moisture lesions. So one of the most common types of moisture lesions I've seen are residents or patients that wear pads, they're incontinent of urine, so technically it's probably urine burns, but it's obviously caused a moisture lesion. But I have also seen moisture lesions in people that are completely continent, they don't wear pads, but they can still get it. So they can get them under the breasts, in the groin areas, on the buttocks. So all sorts of areas you can get these moisture lesions, wherever there's moisture, basically. And the big difference to tell what's a moisture lesion and what's a pressure sore is, with moisture lesions, they are usually like this. They're not rounded, they're completely jagged edges. If it's on the buttocks, they're usually mirrored, not always the case, but they're usually mirrored on each buttock. So say you've got the line of the buttocks there, so each side there'll be this a same sort of pattern, and it's caused that pressure, and it just sort of mirrors each other. It's like they call it the butterfly effect, I think, from what I've heard from people saying. And it's just this red, rashy sort of looking area. Sometimes the skin's broken, sometimes it's not broken. It'll be red, it'll be blanching, and sometimes it doesn't blanch. And also, as part of this, you can have a combined categoried pressure ulcer. So you could have moisture lesion, but then it could have like a category 2 inside of it. So you could have your moisture lesion and then a small ulcer inside of it. So that would be a combined or mixed sort of pressure ulcer. And for both of these, so the moisture lesion or if it's a combined one, that also has to be Datex reported. But for moisture lesions, you don't need a tissue viability nurse to be included in this. So that is it from me. If you need any more information, advice, I'm going to post the links below. So have a look at those links. You can speak to your tissue viability nurses for any more advice, or if you're unsure about categories, anything like that, or a patient if they're at risk. The tissue viability nurses are absolutely amazing, and they'll know exactly what to do, what creams to use, all of that. So just inform them or go to them if you need any more help or information. As always, thank you so much for tuning in. Thanks for watching, and I shall see you next time.